Hello and welcome to the webinar, VELUX Lifetime Carbon Calculation. Before we begin, I'd like to thank our NFRC 2021 sustainability sponsors. Gold, we have Vitro Architectural Glass. Silver, we have Tremco and Schuco. Bronze, we have Energy. And green, Veritas Solutions. Today's webinar will be presented by Hilly Carlson Nielsen, Senior Manager for Sustainability for the VELUX Group, and Kim Jonas, Global Health, Safety, and Environment for the VELUX Group. Both are joining us today from Denmark, where the VELUX Group has its global headquarters. Hilly and Kim will talk about VELUX's Sustainability Strategy 2030 and the methodology behind the company's lifetime carbon neutral plan. Hilly and Kim, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you very much, Jerry.
It's a pleasure to be here.
It is indeed a pleasure to be here. Thank you for inviting both of us. And today I will present our strategy, It's Our Nature. Before I go into detail with the strategy, I'll just give a few words about who we are. Our vision is to lead the development of better living environments with daylight and fresh air through the roof and to be rated as the best in the eyes of our customers. We have been operating since 1941, and today we are in 40 countries, and we are having 27 production sites in 10 countries, and we have 11,000 employees globally. We are owned by VKR Holding, a limited company fully owned by Foundation and the Ken Rasmussen family. In September last year, we launched our strategy. It's called It's Our Nature. With this, we wanted to wrap up our efforts within sustainability. And there are two reasons why we launched this strategy. First of all, our world needs it. There's no doubt that we're all aware of the climate crisis and the devastating consequences of global warming. The time is up. It's time to act. If we all need to succeed in reversing this trend, all actors in the society need to step up and play their part, and not least businesses. And at the VELUX Group, we are fortunate with our ownership and our values because it gives us the privilege to actually be able to do more than most. The second reason is it's who we are. It's our nature to develop a solid business model that thinks long-term and of the benefits of society. This mindset was actually articulated by our founder, Willem Kent Rasmussen, in 1965. It was articulated in what is called the model company objective, and you will see that on the screen. The model company objective actually mirrors what is today called sustainability. It has this environmental, social, and economic aspect because our founder defined that a model company means a company working with products useful to society, which treats its customers, suppliers, employees of all categories better than most and makes a profit. So sustainability has been deeply ingrained in our values, and we have always strived to act responsibly. Now we have launched this new strategy, and we've built our strategy like a house. It has three levels, a foundation, a core, and an attic. Overall, we have set 15 targets across the entire business where we have focused on different aspects of our business. In the bottom, we want to secure a responsible business. And here we have set targets within diversity, within safety, within waste, etc. In the core, we have connected our sustainability strategy to our products and set specific targets to our products. And then the top, and that's what I will focus on today, we want to pioneer climate and nature action. And here we have set three targets. We want to capture our historical carbon footprint, reduce future carbon footprint, and show how to build sustainably. And I will focus on the two first targets, because here we have made an oath to become lifetime carbon neutral. And by this, we mean we are taking responsibility of both our past and future carbon emissions. We call it lifetime carbon neutral. And as far as we know, we are among the first companies in the world to take responsibility of both past and future emissions. First, I will talk about the future. We have listened to science. We will dramatically reduce our future carbon emissions in line with UN's climate panel. We have committed to follow the most ambitious reduction path from the Paris Agreement, the 1.5 degree scenario. And our target is to become a 100% carbon neutral company by 2030 and reduce 50% of the CO2 from our value chain. And we have joined a visionary club of large companies with the ambition to act on climate change. It is called the Science-Based Target Initiative. As I said, we've committed to the most ambitious reduction path, the 1.5, and we are following this and will report on it annually. If we go into our carbon footprint, we actually have calculated how much our carbon footprint comes from our own operations and how much comes from the value chain. And most of the carbon footprint comes from our value chain, the 94%. And that is the carbon footprint coming from the products that we use in our windows, steel, aluminium, glazing, etc. And then that was about the future. Looking at the past, we will capture our historical carbon footprint through forest conservation. And here we have entered into a partnership with WWF, and we are to capture our historical carbon footprint in this partnership. Our historical carbon footprint is equivalent to 5.6 million tons, and that will be captured through forest and biodiversity projects all the way towards 2041. So by our 100-year anniversary in 2041, we will be lifetime carbon neutral. So it's a 20-year program with WWF, and the new partnership is new, but the method is as old as time itself, using trees' unique abilities to capture CO2 from the air. So with this climate oath to become lifetime carbon neutral, we want to inspire other companies to take similar action. We want to share our method of calculating historical carbon emissions, and hopefully we will get more companies to take similar action, and together we can create a more sustainable world. And now I'll just give the floor to Kim Jonas, my good colleague, who will go into more details on our method and the way we have calculated. So over to you, Kim.
Thank you very much. I will start with just a brief explanation about scope 1, 2, and 3. Maybe you are all familiar with it, but if in case somebody is not, then what we're looking at here when we're talking about lifetime carbon neutrality is looking at what we call scope 1 and 2 emissions. That means scope 1 are the direct emissions that comes from our own operations, our company facilities, and company vehicles. That's scope one. Scope two are the indirect emissions that comes from the purchased power we are using for our operations. Of course, electricity could also be steam, heating, and cooling in some cases. So that's what we call scope one and two. That also includes company cars, by the way, of course, that's scope one. So that's what we are talking about when we are talking about being company carbon neutral or being lifetime carbon neutral. Scope 3, as Helle mentioned, is actually the most significant carbon footprint. And if you consider our business, it's the upstream carbon footprint from the goods and services we purchase and use for our production. And it's also relating to downstream Scope 3, relating to transportation, the use of our products, and the end of life handling of our products. Helle showed you the ratio. It was something like 6% that was coming from scope 1 and 2. That ratio is actually not so unusual. It's actually typical for many manufacturing companies, and I would expect that other windows producers would see some similar ratios. So it's not so specific for VELUX that this ratio is pretty high. The next slide, please. Here you can see a graph that we developed based on the company carbon neutral, the lifetime carbon neutral calculations that we made. And you can see that based on the colors here, we started our production in 1941. And the estimate to begin with is the gray color. That's where we have used a calculation method. I'll come deeper into that, where we estimate the emissions. In the black area, we have actually measured starting from 2007 and up till today, of course. So that's more very solid data. And the white part is the prognosis part. What are we going to have in the future? And as you can see, we are reducing very aggressively our carbon emissions, and we have set a target to become company carbon neutral by 2030. Helle just explained to you that we'll do that in alignment with science. So we'll be following a reduction trajectory equivalent to the 1.5 global warming scenario. And this is here where we take actions as a company. That's the first step you actually need to take when you are signing up in a way for lifetime carbon neutrality, because you need to prove that you are, sweeping your own doorstep first, and you are really reducing significantly your carbon footprint. The blue part is what Helle mentioned. It's the partnership with WWF. It's here where we capture or erase our historical carbon footprint, and by 2041, as mentioned, we will become lifetime carbon neutral. Next slide, please. Before we dive into lifetime carbon neutral, just a few words about our company carbon neutral strategy. I think many of you are in the same business as us, and you also can use the same levers. To start with, electricity is a major part of our footprint. It's the dominant part. And what we can do here, and also you, other businesses, manufacturing companies, is to start using renewable electricity. That can be done by renewable power purchase agreements. And it's available on the market, especially in the US. Actually, it was started there, as I understand. And if you buy new renewable capacity on the market, you are ensuring that it has a material impact on the grid in your area. And thereby, you are creating what we call additionality. You are adding new renewable power generation to the market. So that's the best way you can do it. We also, of course, have to look into the other renewable energy sources, heat, for instance. We have to be 100% using renewable heating. And since the power is green, you can think about using heat pumps, using electricity to create heat. You can also, if you have wood production, of course, look into utilizing your wood for generating heat locally. In best case, if you have certified wood, of course, because then you make sure that new trees are planted. That's a much stronger story, of course. Basically, this is all a good business case. And you should definitely also focus on energy efficiency, of course, because that will bring down your energy costs. It's good business. And in our case, and I think also in your case, you can harvest a lot of energy savings. And we have set an investment rate of up to 4 to 6 years payback time and 10 years for solar PVE. So it is doable to earn money here as part of eliminating your carbon footprint. We're also going to install some solar cells, like you can see in the picture here on our own sites, and shifting to 100% zero emission company cars by 2030 also. We believe that is doable. If you look on the trend, what is happening right now on the market for electric cars, it will be electric cars that we are aiming for here. Next slide, please. Okay, let's dive a little into the calculation. Why did we do it? What was the method based on? And when and how did we do it? The why is about the method itself. Actually, there was no method existing when we had this idea of dealing with our historical carbon footprint. There was no standard for it, so we needed to invent our own. And at the same time, we thought, okay, at the same time we are developing this, why not also have the aim of eventually sharing this method with others so other people can use this as a kind of shareware. So we started to do that. Another challenge, of course, was that when you look on data far back in history, our company is 80 years old, you will meet a challenge about how to get data. And we need to meet that challenge also and make the right assumptions and calculations. And we do not have emission factor data also going back in time. Emission factors is about, for instance, how much CO2 is produced per kilowatt hour electricity consumed. Also, our energy consumption data, if we go decades back, we didn't have data on that also. So all this is made us require to develop a new strategy for how to calculate historical carbon footprint. Regarding the method, it's clear you need to align as far as possible to existing material, and what is generally recognized as the Bible for greenhouse gases, the protocol, a greenhouse gas protocol standard that is applicable. You can Google it and find it, and in case you don't know it, it's available for free. Then, of course, we also need to look into operational activity data, because we did have produced number of units all the way back, fortunately, to 1941 in our records. You can also find emission factors going somewhat in the past. And besides that, you need to make conservative estimates and assumptions to be able to calculate. We started this calculation in 2019, and the overall method was developed by ourselves, the principals, basically. But we also, of course, quickly saw that to really be trustworthy here and also to have a review and feel safe, we needed to make an arrangement, collaboration with a partner, and we contacted Carbon Trust. It's a UK-based company to have guidance and support. We really wanted to develop a robust method that we could share and have be credible about it. And also, Carbon Trust, they have another business area called Assurance, and we engaged with them also to finally verify our historical emissions. Next slide, please. A very basic component in this calculation is to use a baseline year. And as you can see in the pie chart to the right, you can see that our greenhouse gas emissions shown in ton CO2 equivalents is mainly dominated by electricity, the blue part of the pie chart, 66%, followed by the natural gas consumption and vehicles, our company cars mainly, is about 13%. And finally, oil is 3%. We also have small carbon emissions from biomass. Even though we are using a lot of biomass, it's calculated as almost completely zero carbon due to the fact that it's on-site waste wood and it's certified wood. So this is the pie chart illustrating the baseline, and we used that baseline and combined it with an index, because in 2007 that was the first carbon footprint that was made for VELUX. So we used that as the baseline year, 2007, and the pie chart to the right. And then we said, okay, if we see how much we have produced in 2007, we could actually make an index that we could project backwards. So using the produced number of units, we could actually calculate the ratio of energy spent. It was energy we used as a measure here, and then using assumptions about the emission factors that we could also project backwards the carbon emissions. And that is illustrated by the formula you can see in the bottom left corner. Next slide, please. Besides doing this scope definition and the baseline year, we also have to make conservative estimates. The first estimate you need to consider is energy efficiency improvements, because if you go back in time, you will see less and less effective energy efficiency. Actually, in Europe, at least, I assume also in USA, energy efficiency was really put on the agenda as part of the oil crisis in 1972. Before that, it was really not a major issue because energy prices were so low that many companies who did not already have a high energy costs were not maybe not so focused on it. And that included also VELUX, to be honest, because as a manufacturing company, as historically, energy bills has not been the dominant cost for producing for us. So what we have done is to historically adjust the energy efficiency part. So it improved from 1972 and onwards. Another thing that changes over time is the electricity grid emission factors. That means how much CO2 is produced per megawatt hours of electricity produced. And also here, the more we go back in time, the more black the power generation becomes. And in Europe, and maybe also in the case of USA, we simply said that before 1990, we made the conservative estimate that it's similar to what we can see in Poland, which is almost 100% driven by coal. And that has also been the case in most other European countries. Another shift is shifting from using gas oil to natural gas. And also here again, we made some assumptions and said that, okay, after this shift was occurring gradually from 89 to 95, and after that, we can see a steep decrease in the use of gas oil and an increase in natural gas. Finally, historical emissions from our vehicle fleet. We also used index numbers here because we knew the carbon footprint from 2007. So we could project back in time using our productivity and the number of units produced and thereby get a number of company cars and vehicles back in time. On top of that, we also said that the vehicle fuel efficiency also changed over time. So we added some correlations there to also compensate for you can say worse energy efficiency when you go back in time. Next slide, please. Okay, so based on these calculation principles, methodologies, and the scope, we have developed these documents. We have actually three levels of documents: an executive summary, which will be shared with you, a methodology statement, which dives into the assumptions and descriptions of the method itself, and a deeper level even, we also have a tool, an Excel file for calculating. You can see that in the bottom right corner. It's much more detailed, but it's hopefully it can help you who are going to test it out, maybe in your own company, to how can we actually set up this calculation in a good way. And as you can see here, we have divided in 9 historical periods, because we want to address as good as possible the different trends over the years. Next slide, please. This about transparency is, of course, crucial for any company. We really want to be transparent about how we did it. We want to share it with others who have interest in doing the same, at least starting with the calculation. So to have this transparency and trust, as mentioned, we teamed up with Carbon Trust as an advisor. And on top of that, WWF, International Climate Experts, our partners, they also reviewed it deeply and of course accepted that the methodology is valid. And it also is a ticket in a way to join a partnership with them, because they of course also are depending on having calculations which they can also defend themselves as joining in a partnership. So we have these two verification reports from Carbon Trust, and we have two assurance statements also from them. We are very fortunate because we could actually use this material, of course, having invested in it, we could share it, and we have used it to demonstrate our commitment towards the global, the public. And we are very happy that this graph was actually used, for instance, in Bloomberg in the 1st of September. And you can see the graph in a nice layout to the right, and then nice articles that we have been very proud of and happy about, that it actually, there's a big momentum about carbon, of course, about global warming and this concept is, as like Helle mentioned, a new concept even globally. There are very few companies. We are actually in the league now with companies like Google and Microsoft, even though they, as far as I know, have not really described how they're going to do it. We have described how we are going to do it, to be honest, and we are already starting these forest projects. So all this publicity and branding has really paid off, and I'm really sure it will pay off. In case you want to join this, you can still join it as being pioneers and leaders within your businesses. And to be honest, that's not a normal, maybe not a normal perception of our industry. Some people might perceive us as a bit conservative and maybe also a bit slow on the sustainability agenda. I've heard about that. But you can actually make a giant leap here if you start working with these concepts here, company carbon neutral, starting with that and then adding on lifetime carbon neutral. In our case, it has really demonstrated calculating and best practices. When to start, how to start, who to get support from, and who to involve. Well, first of all, when to start, start as soon as you like, as soon as you can. The agenda is a hot topic, so why wait? Of course, you need to present your idea to your managers, your board, and it also takes time to grow the idea and get it approved. But I would not, in case you have interest, just start doing it. To be honest, when I made the first calculation, I did it in half an hour on a piece of paper, you know, early morning. And I calculated something like 6 million tons. And after the final detailed calculations was made, we ended up by something like 4.0, like around that. And then adding the projected future emissions, we ended up at the figure Helle just mentioned. So it's just to say you can actually do some quick estimates here, and no reason to wait if you're interested. Who to get support from? I believe that if you have an internal expert that, you know, can calculate these things and data are available to a certain extent, you can get a long way on your own, but I would also recommend using climate experts like companies who can verify and validate the calculations. And even third party also, of course, if you want to move ahead and you want to demonstrate your commitment. About who to involve, a few people from your organization who knows about energy consumption data, production data, and who are skilled in doing calculations is needed, of course. Top management is key, as mentioned. You need to co-develop this with your top management and engage them from the beginning, of course, to get their support and buy-in, at least for the first step, to do the calculation and see, okay, what does this mean for our business? What is our carbon footprint? What does the business case look like here? What would it cost? You can get actually from the internet a range of what does these forest projects cost per ton CO2 captured by the trees. That's available data on the market, and you can add it to your carbon footprint number, and then you can see, okay, we're talking about this ratio of investment over a certain period of time. It can be distributed over 10, 20, 30 years, depending on your appetite and how aggressively you would like to reduce your lifetime carbon neutral footprint. Next slide, please. Okay, I will just try to sum up as best as I can, give you some advice if you want to begin exploring this route, this new concept. Of course, get management buy-in and commitment. Make it part of a strategy proposal. Give them some insights, involve them. That's what we did, and it was very successful. We worked across our organization, top down, and also across the different areas. It was a quite interesting journey. It's a cross-functional team that needs to be in place, using data, having economic people evaluating things, engaging with your line management and top management. One thing you can start with as good advice is, of course, to look on your own business first. So it's about being company carbon neutral, looking on energy efficiency, doing energy screenings, review business cases, and make this part of a rollout plan. How can you become company carbon neutral? You will probably discover that you will be earning money on that. So it's more about the payback time level you are ready to accept. Also, as mentioned, aim for 100% renewable power. you can actually quite quickly eliminate maybe in our, like in our case, 2/3 of your CO2 emissions. And by doing that, you would likely be able to fulfill the SBTI, the Science-Based Target Initiative's requirement. It's just to say that that is a highly effective way of getting down in then your CO2 emissions using these power purchase agreements. Also, of course, look on your on-site renewable energy options. If you have, as mentioned, waste wood produced on-site, that is really ideal, and preferably certified wood. You can also look into solar PVs, of course, on your roofs or on your premises, on-site PVA solutions, on top of maybe making these power purchase agreements. It's a good signal, makes employees proud, and you can demonstrate in your local community that you are doing something on the sites also that is visible. Also a good advice from our side, to create credibility internally, externally, consider signing up to international call to actions. Science-based targets initiative is one of them. Another one is called RE100, standing for renewable electricity, 100%. Thereby you are gaining transparency and credibility, and you can more easily go to the market and do your communication and your branding much more effectively to harvest the potential fully. Regarding scope 3, the value chain, you could also call it, it's of course also very important that you do not only focus on scope 1 and 2 emissions. So if you sign up for science-based target initiatives, you should also sign up for the scope 3 reduction scenario. You can choose between different ambitions levels here, but I would certainly recommend to include that in your carbon reduction strategy also, because you need to demonstrate that you have this holistic focus, and you also focus on you take responsibility for your full carbon footprint in your supply chain, and as shown by the figures, it's actually the majority of your carbon footprint. So it's a challenge because you need to work with your suppliers, tier 1, tier 2, maybe even tier 3, but there is help to get there. For instance, in VELUX, where we have joined the CDP supply chain program. You can Google that, CDP supply chain program. It's a program where you can start collecting data, which is the critical thing here also on scope 3. And based on data, you can take informed actions and influence your supply chain upstream. Last but not least, if you go this way, you will have an excellent opportunity to promote your company. You can create also, besides branding your company as an employer, you're branding yourself, you can also have a catalytical effect. Because when you share this with your others, your colleagues, even globally, to be honest, because it has global attention, that you are part of the green transitioning, where you can actually have this catalytical effect that you will inspire others, and then you are really pushing to move forward on the climate agenda. So it goes way beyond your company, even the business area. It's a global issue you're tapping into here and really demonstrating that you are part of the solution. So I would say going into this area is not just to become green. It is an integral part of a business strategy. If you consider what is going to happen within the next 5 years, 10 years, I think most specialists agree that you will see new regimes coming up. We simply need to make this green transition. Politicians will start taking actions. We can expect carbon taxing. It will be much more hard to continue business as usual. If you continue with using fossil fuels, you can expect increased costs. You can also in that way see it as a kind of a economical feasible way, and so the people, planet and profit thing, which you can say constitutes sustainability, they all have to be there for future businesses. So instead of reactively waiting for that to happen and having to take the transition, it's recommended and to take proactive actions and actually make it part of your business strategy. And that's also why you need to engage with top management. You can really inspire them, I hope, and believe if you present this calculation for your own company, starting with your existing carbon footprint, but also giving them the perspective of what more could we do. I think for most of your companies, you could actually have a business case that one pays for the other, because if you improve your energy efficiency, that gives you some savings that you could actually say that is invested in historical carbon footprint reductions. But you will find out. Then I will give over to you, Helle, for what did we learn?
Thank you very much, Kim. Yes, I'll just wrap up a few points about what did we learn. I think Kim has mentioned a few times that it's important to have a top-down, bottom-up process where it's possible to develop an idea like this and to have strategic discussions with the top management along the way. And us having a visionary top management really made it happen and made it possible to actually agree to the plan and to commit to become lifetime carbon neutral in that top-down, bottom-up process. Then don't be afraid to make assumptions, but be transparent and share. Kim has been around what the assumptions we've taken, and I think it's important that we cannot know it with 100% certainty, but we can know it as quite close to that. And then partnering is key to develop an idea like this. We initiated the partnership with the WWF with the aim of becoming a lifetime carbon neutral and capture our historical carbon footprint. But the idea has also been further developed with WWF. And in terms of the support we got from Carbon Trust, it also developed our method and it made it even more robust. So seeking external advice, partnering, etc., is making what we do even better. And then finally, simple communication. Kim has showed the graph a few times. As mentioned, it was also published in the Bloomberg and in other articles. And it shows, we think at least, in a simple way what the commitment is about. If you all otherwise explain it, it can be a bit complicated. But this graph shows it in a simple way. And then we also made a campaign movie. Maybe some of you have seen it. Otherwise, go have a look if you are interested. It's called A Plan for the Future That Starts with Our Past. And here our CEO, David Briggs, is explaining our commitment to become lifetime carbon neutral. And WWF is also in that movie explaining how forests, and we present how we will capture our historical carbon footprint through forest conservation. So that was some of the learnings. As Kim has mentioned, we have the executive summary, the full report of the methodology, Excel file, we can share that. We can share the slides from today's session and the VELUX sustainability report. And if you want to know more about the VELUX sustainability strategy, you could go to our website, velux.com. So, Jeremy, I think there are questions as well.
Yes, and thank you, Helly and Kim, for sharing VELUX's sustainability strategy and the methodology behind the company's lifetime carbon neutral plan. And for anybody viewing the recording of this webinar, links of all these resources can be found in the video description. Our members have submitted some questions. The first question is, from one manufacturer to another, what would be your advice to manufacturers just beginning their journey to reducing their carbon footprint?
It's a really good question. And the 8 points I just talked about in the slide package, I think that really guides companies, as far as I can explain it, the best way, how you can start, what you should focus at, moving from knowing your situation to taking actions on your company carbon neutral. How can you practically do that? So if you look on that slide, you will find all what I really have to share here, but basically you need to start by reducing your own carbon footprint by energy efficiency, on-site renewable, and renewable power purchase. And on top of that, you can then use a calculation method to to calculate historical carbon footprint and set up a business case, maybe even wrap it up in one business case, because the top management always likes to have, you know, what is the full picture here, and then they can pick, cherry pick maybe, and you can have discussions about, okay, is this the right balance we're having here? Should we have more time to do the historical carbon footprint capture? Because you can, I mean, you're free to choose whatever. You can choose, in our case, we chose to reduce 100% by 2041. You could also say we'll do 20% within the next 10 years, and then we say 2050, 100%, whatever fits your business. You can actually scale these investments and costs, also regarding the savings from energy efficiency. So there's a lot to play with here to design your own carbon company carbon neutral strategy and lifetime carbon neutral strategy.
You talk about the importance of partnerships to reaching lifetime carbon neutral. So in addition to the World Wildlife Fund, what other partnerships does VELUX have to reach this goal?
Well, I can mention at least one partnership we have just made with Schneider Electric, because when we looked into this renewable power purchase market, it quickly became obvious for us that we needed help, because it's quite complex to evaluate these projects and the supply there. So we made a partnership with Schneider Electric, and they are currently helping us to find the right projects. At the moment, we have about 100 projects offers, and they are screening them, helping us based on our sustainability requirements that we have set to find the right offers, and we expect to sign a contract by the end of the year to cover our electrical consumption. It's about 160 gigawatt hours, so we buy enough, so we have enough for the next 10 years as part of such an agreement that typically goes 10 years ahead. So Schneider Electric is one partner. I know in the States you also have some company called Level 10. I don't know them too much, but I know they apparently should be part of the two biggest in the world. So that's what I know, the one partnership. We also, of course, have the WWF partnership, as mentioned by Helle. But I will also say that when you sign up for these call to actions like science-based targets, Renewable 100 and others, if you go to the website We Mean Business, you can find other commitments. When you signed up to those, you also get access to the networks. That's a major part of signing up also. It's not only credibility, it's also getting insights by sharing with other peers and colleagues from the industry. So we are using these networks to a large degree also.
How much of the carbon offset was invested into tree plantings?
Yes, I can reply to that. The capturing of our historical carbon footprint, the 5.6 million tons, it is expected to be captured in five projects around the world, managed and developed by WWF. And we have agreed that with these five projects, we expect that approximately 30% of the forest projects will concern planting of new trees, and 70% will be conservation protection of old forest. So that's how we will capture this historical carbon footprint going forward towards 2041.
The next question is, why is VELUX sharing this methodology, and what do you hope to see in the fenestration industry as a whole?
Thank you very much for that very good question. We want to inspire with sharing our method. We want to inspire and hopefully we will inspire other companies to take similar action. And it would be great if the fenestration industry will be front runners within this, of both taking responsibility of past and future emissions. So that's why we are sharing the method.
Maybe just one addition here, because there is also a unique opportunity for the fenestration business, because typically when you look on your energy consumption, first of all, we are basically not heavy energy consumers compared to other industries like, you know, petrochemical, pharmaceutical, other process industries. We are manufacturing companies, and that gives us an opportunity, because our historical carbon footprint is not as dramatically high as those businesses. If they should capture the historical carbon, they would really have to reduce a very, very high number of CO2. But in our case, as we are not so energy intensive, it's more achievable for us. So it is within our reach to do it. And that's an opportunity for the fenestration industry as well as other manufacturing companies, I believe.
Thank you. The next few questions are about supply chain. So was the carbon offset just for your operations, or does it also include the supply chain?
Maybe I can take that one. It only includes our own business. We are not offsetting anything regarding our value chain or scope 3 emissions. We are focusing on our own footprint and taking responsibility for that. So that's part of the lifetime carbon neutral concept. It's managing our own footprint. And then, as Helle mentioned, on the value chain emissions, we have set an ambition to reduce that by 50% by 2030. That's the most aggressive commitment you can make according to the science-based target initiatives. And to be honest, it's very, very challenging. And we don't see all solutions yet, but we dare to do it because we believe we can do it if we start working and collaborating with our suppliers. It will be a global trend. Nobody has all the answers yet, and you don't need to have all the answers yet. But you need to make a commitment to make things change. And everybody in the supply chain knows this. All suppliers knows this. All companies knows this. So you're joining a big wave of global climate initiative and efforts here. So I would just say we would do it and start working with it. It will improve your business model because your products will be more green and more sustainable, meaning more robust, considering the future of your company.
That's a good segue to the next question. With 94% of the embodied carbon in your supply chain, what measures and materials have you started to look into with your suppliers?
Well, as mentioned, on scope 3 emissions, we have started with this CDP supply chain program, and we are advancing very quickly on getting valid data, because when you start this journey, you only have the generic key figures. For instance, how much CO2 comes from a kilogram of aluminium produced. That's generic figures. It's a world average figure, but you cannot really rely on that. If you want to reduce your scope 3, you have to be supplier specific. You need to know, okay, where do I source my aluminium, for instance? Aluminium is the biggest carbon footprint we have in VELUX. It's a use of aluminium. And secondly comes glass and metals. So when you should engage with the suppliers, you should mix a strategy where you have a broad focus. How can we influence our suppliers as in general? It could be, for instance, motivating, inspiring, and helping them to be using renewable electricity, all of them. I mean, everybody can do that. But on top of that, you need also to focus on the most significant contributors, like in our case, aluminium, and probably also in other fenestration businesses, it's the same materials. So you need to start collaborating with your supply chains, collaborating also with the organizations, for instance, that work with these things, so you're not alone. Within the aluminium industry, they are heavily challenged by their carbon footprints, and there are lots of initiatives you can join, so you're not alone on that journey either.
So the next question is, why does VELUX feel that they needed to account for their historical footprint as opposed to only the future footprint?
I can elaborate on that. I think we're fortunate with our ownership being a foundation and family-owned company, and with the values and the DNA of being a model company objective. We are fortunate that we can do so. We can not only take responsibility of our future emissions, but also take responsibility of our past emission.
Maybe I could add something here, because if you see it from a nature perspective, you can say in a way Mother Nature doesn't care whether the emission comes today, tomorrow, or in the past, because it all adds up to the concentration of CO2 in the atmosphere anyway. So our global challenge on this planet is actually to reduce the carbon in the atmosphere. And if you can do something where you also, as a company, and that's a new thing, as a company, not as a government or a big what can I say, powerful governmental organizations, you can actually do something as a company to deal with your past emissions also. It is within reach, and you even do not need to wait for new technologies to develop, because a lot of actions is actually postponed because you believe that it's not available. But you can actually use nature-based solutions today. You can start doing it today. It's already there, and people have done it already. So far, it has been used mainly for offsetting current emissions. The idea is quite simple, actually. You use the same methodology, carbon capture by forests, to capture your past emissions. It's looking backwards and taking responsibility for what you've already emitted.
The next question is your carbon reduction plan also considering production in China and Asia?
Yes, obviously. Yes, for sure. It's a global target, covers all what we do in our business. In our case, we have production in China and US also, mainly in US, to be honest. Our key production is in Europe, but we do have in VELUX Greenwood, production, we are producing to the US market also. It's completely covered by all our targets, historical, company carbon neutral, and within all the pledges we have made.
The next question is, do you have any specific activities planned for North America to support these goals, or is it all in Europe?
Certainly. All the things we are doing about company carbon neutral, our own footprint to reduce that moving forward, for sure also covers all our US sites, from the tiniest sales office to the production sites in for instance, VELUX Greenwood in South Carolina. So they are going through the same programs to be called the Energy Excellence Program. They're going to get the same support from group level. And we have also in VELUX made an internal VELUX climate fund with a significant number of millions of Danish kroner that will enable and move the barriers for the local sites so they can get funding internally to actually do these energy efficiency on-site renewable investments. We have done everything we can to remove the barriers so all our sites can take part of this journey. There's global consultant support, global energy monitoring, and global funding. And thereby, we're really supporting all our sites, so including in the US, to be part of this journey. There's no one left behind here.
What do you recommend for a staff size needed to manage a project for a similar size company?
A similar size, I assume that is compared to VELUX. Maybe as Ella showed you, we are about 11,000, I think 500 employees. And to mature the idea and the strategy, you don't really need to be so many people. Of course, when it comes to implementing, it's another story. To begin with, we were about 2-3 persons that were working on this together with an external consultant. It's about getting the data, doing the calculations, and presenting the business cases. When it comes to your company carbon neutral program, it's of course a little bit more complex because in a way it's easy to buy at WWF the historical carbon capture. It's easy in the sense that you of course need to work a lot with the contracting. It's not easy in that way sense because you need to define a lot of things. But compared to the workload you need to do to move your company carbon neutral to zero. Of course, that's an internal work that is much more comprehensive. Here we are talking about all our production sites. We're talking about 3 to 4 year programs and a 10 year head working with that. So doing the strategy, presenting it, engaging with your organization is doable, I would say, with a team of 2, 3, 4 people working. I don't know, maybe something like 30, 40, 50% for some months, and then you have a basis. And then you need, of course, to implement the strategy. That's a completely other story.
And just to add on that one, the complete strategy, it's our nature, which consists of 15 targets, as I showed in the beginning. Here we have been more than 100 colleagues involved in setting these targets across the business. And now these colleagues and a lot more colleagues are very much involved in actually implementing. So to succeed with a broad and anchored strategy with the targets covering across the business, more colleagues of course needs to be involved. But for this specific calculation on the lifetime carbon neutral calculation, it was actually a small group, and I think it's important to have it in a small group to have things moving fast.
Well, thank you so much. Maybe one final question. How can other manufacturers or industry and partners get involved in your work?
Get involved in our work is actually, I think this presentation today is kind of a starting point and an attempt for us to help people to think in this direction, and also the concrete tools can help you to calculate your historical carbon footprint. Then, of course, we also have the partner WWF, and Helle can talk more about that. But they are, of course, also ready to hear from companies who will actually hear more about what could they offer. Of course, there are other solutions on the market, so to speak. We selected the WWF because they are world leading on forest preservation and also biodiversity. They have boots on the ground, and they have been dealing. That's a rock solid organization if you compare to credibility also. So. That's why we took that decision. But Helle, maybe you would add something.
I think we will engage a lot with our supply chain to reach our target of reducing 50%, and we're also engaging with manufacturers in industry organizations like NFRC and other industry organizations, and I think the more we discuss and engage with each other, the better, and the more we inspire each other and get to know more about how can you make strategies like this, and how can you make a real tangible change within your supply chain and within your company. I think that's good for an industry and also for the world, so to speak.
Well, thank you so much. And on behalf of NFRC and our members, we really thank you both, Helle and Kim, and for sharing VELUX's sustainability strategy and the methodology behind this.
Thank you very much for having us.
Thank you. It was a pleasure.
It was a pleasure.